Democrat from Virginia. Senator, good morning.
Hey, Chris, good morning.
Is this a good sign? Does it at least crack the door a little bit and make you more hopeful that we might resolve what has clearly been one of the big sticking points here?
Well, it does make me more hopeful. I've been part of the gang of six. We've got 45 senators saying we need to do this. Now we've got 100 members of the House, almost equally divided, Democrats and Republicans. And this all ties in. I know, you know, we just went from your previous segment on Greece now to the U.S. debt crisis. They are intertwined, and they directly affect people's retirement, their ability to get jobs. The whole financial structure of the world, like it or not, is interconnected right now. And one of the most important things we could do in the United States to kind of regain consumer confidence, business confidence, and candidly, the world's confidence, is show that at least in America, we're not going to wait to get in a Greek-like circumstance. We're going to act now, try to find a way to get $4 trillion off of our debt, have that with a mix of both revenues through tax reform and entitlement reform, and we ought to take advantage of this opportunity with the supercommittee to do that.
There's a couple of polls out right now, and I'd like to get your reaction to them.
Sure.
The first one is the new Quinnipiac that just came out. 48% say the solution should include only spending cuts, not tax increases. And then that same poll finds that 2 out of 3 Americans don't think a deal will get done. A lot of pessimism out there about what's going on in Washington. What would you say to the American people?
Well, I would say if you've had to look at our recent track record, I understand why people are pessimistic. There's a reason why Congress has only got a 9% approval rating. And I got to tell you, I'm part of the 91% who thinks Congress is not doing its job. I mean, this debt deal has become almost a proxy for whether our institutions are up to the challenge. I do think, though, that Americans will support something that, as long as everybody's got some skin in the game. You know, I think if you explain to the American people that, yes, spending's at an all-time high, 25% of our GDP, revenues at a 70-year low, only 15% of our GDP, that 10% difference, we're basically borrowing from China. And if you look over the last 70 years, the only time our government has been in budget balance, and it's only been about 5 of those years out of the last 70, has been when spending and revenues have been roughly at 20%. That means we've got to decrease spending. It means we've got to find a way to increase some revenues. And as long as there's a fairness approach, as long as we've got a balance in this, I think the American public would welcome that.
There is a Senate vote, as you know, this afternoon on a piece of the president's jobs bill with the $60 billion for infrastructure. But as you also know, Republicans are expected to unanimously vote it down because it would be paid for with a new tax on millionaires. They argue the president is more interested in picking fights than in compromise. What's your thought about this battle?
Well, I don't think anybody believes that we can, even though I'm as focused on the debt as I am, that we can simply cut and tax our way out of this problem. We also have to have a growth agenda. And part of that growth agenda that I think, you know, traditionally we've all supported is we got to invest in our infrastructure. Now, if some of my colleagues on the other side don't like the president's pay for it, let's figure out another way to pay for it. But what it says to me is that we probably won't make a large amount of progress on a growth agenda until we can, you know, kind of break the logjam around the overall question of revenues and the overall question of entitlement reform.
One more quick question about jobs, if I can, in our last minute, because you just got back from a big announcement on the billion-plus change campaign.
Right.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. What it's saying is, as government is cutting back, more and more nonprofits are having to pick up the slack. We've been trying to encourage corporate America to step up and provide more pro bono services. Today we announced that 50 companies have committed $1 billion worth of value to invest in pro bono organizations or not-for-profit organizations. We'd like to see that grow. We'd like to up to 300 companies. That's good for America's bottom line. It's candidly good for corporate bottom lines as well, because there's an awful lot of folks that are pretty upset at business at this point. Maybe not as upset as they are at politicians, but if business can show an ability to give back, that helps everyone.
Senator Warner, it's good to see you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
More violent clashes between police and Occupy.